Kavarachsanya, Birshut, Maariv Rabbi, Harav Hershel Schachter Shlita, Harav Professor Avraham Steinberg Shlita, Rabbanim, Talmidim, honored guests here in person and joining us virtually. Welcome to this evening's program on medical ethics and halacha, where we will hear two lectures, one on abortion and one on fertility. The subject matter being discussed this evening, how we analyze medical science and deduce practical application through the prism of Torah, is the synthesis of Torah Umada, is the mission and vision of Yeshiva University. The exploration of these ethical challenges and the halachic implications for future generations are emblematic of the core Torah values that we hold dear. I'd like to thank Harav Meir Goldberg for sharing a beautiful insight with me. We need look no further than the parshiot of these few weeks to understand the fortitude of the Jewish mother. No parshiot are more apropos to the discussion of abortion and fertility than the sugya of Paro and the Mialdot Shifra and Pua. In the absence of natural abortion, Paro commanded the midwives to terminate all male births and to allow the female births to live. He then explains himself to his Egyptian subjects by saying, Hava nidchak malo. We must outwit B'nai Yisrael and limit their population growth in order to prevent their rebellion and their joining our enemies to destroy us. Having witnessed the genius of Yosef HaTzadik, the Egyptians could not imagine that it would even be possible to outwit B'nai Yisrael. So what was Paro thinking? And why would he believe the Mialdot would acquiesce to murdering their brethren? He then commands his entire nation to kill the Jewish males. If he was going to take that route anyway, why bother going to the Mialdot first? And why start with Hava Nidchak Malo? Paro recognized the power of the Jewish woman, her spirit and courage, her strength and determination, her guardianship of Jewish continuity. The wisdom of Miriam appealing to her father Amram to visit her mother Yocheved, and the defiance of Shifra and Pua demonstrated their foresight of these courageous women that the future of Am Yisrael was in peril. They knew that by the DNA of Jewish mothers and their fortitude, Nigalu Avotenu, they saw and understood that B'nai Yisrael would never participate in Cheta Ego. What Paro wanted was the DNA. He wanted their Chachma, the DNA of the Jewish nation. By terminating the male births and allowing the females to live, the females would eventually couple with the Egyptian men, and he would have achieved Hava Nidchak Malo by having Jewish DNA and Chachma. Why turn first to the Mialdot? He saw that all the birthing stones and birthing rooms were empty. So they would have to tell Paro, our women are so fertile that they deliver in the fields before we can even get to them. Hence the command to his people to murder the males wherever they could be found. He wanted the Chachma, the insight, the Otzma, and the will of the Jewish mother for himself, in order to safeguard the future of his nation. It is this very strength and this noble sense of purpose that compels a Jewish mother to ensure the growth of the Jewish nation, to do all in her power to bring every pregnancy to a thriving birth and protect her offspring, and to preserve life and prevent loss in any way possible. To expound on these critical areas of medical ethics and halacha, we are privileged to have with us two Torah giants and experts in these fields, among the greatest Talmidei Chachamim and Poskim of our generation. We will begin with our own Rosh Yeshiva, the Rosh Kollel of the Marcos and Adina Katz Kollel, Nathan and Vivian Fink, Distinguished Professorial Chair in Talmud, and Rosh Yeshiva at Yeshiva University's Yeshiva Rabbeinu Yitzchak Elchanan, Hagaon Rav Hershel Schachter.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. A few years ago, I was visiting in London. There was a rabbinical conference. Believe it or not, there are conferences where rabbonim from America who went through all of these issues already helped out the rabbonim in England, who were 50 years behind us, dealing with the same issues that we dealt with 50 years ago. So I remember on a Friday morning, I had breakfast by Diane Gelly. He's the son of Rabbi Gelly, who was passed away already. He was a local rabbi in Washington Heights. I had breakfast by him, so he was discussing with me the following Shaila. They have a lot of Russians who live there in London. who are not observant yet. And the daughter of one of the girls who was studying in the local Beis Yankiv in London, and there was some Shabbaton, and the girl became pregnant. So they were gonna kick her out of there. If they'll find out that she's pregnant, they're gonna drop her from the Beis Yankiv, and the parents are not observant yet. And the girl probably will not be able to become observant at all. So the shaila was, is there any room to be lenient on an abortion over here? So the dayan pulled out, he had a copy of the Tshuvas Torah Chesed, one of the big rabbonim. The practice used to be years ago that many rabbonim in Europe, when they would retire, they would move to Yerushalayim. They would join the Badats of Deira Haredes. Deira Haredes was the rabbin of the Ashkenazim. Everybody was Sfardim. And in recent years, the Ashkenazim moved, and so they all joined the rabbinate of the Deira Haredes. So the author of the Torah Chesed was a Rav in Europe, and he moved there. So he became a member of the Badats. So he has two volumes, one volume Chelek Arachayim, one volume Chelek Avinez, and he has two tshuvas about abortions. And he has a whole presentation that I'd like to give over today. This Techemed is an encyclopedia, before Encyclopedia Talmudit. Techemed is an encyclopedia. It's approximately alphabetically arranged, not exactly 100%. So this Techemed has a whole section about abortions. It quotes that if you look in Achrenim, there are three opinions, whether we hold the halacha, abortion is mutter, osam in HaTorah, or osam in the Rabban. The Pashtus is that the accepted opinion is that it's osam in HaTorah, because the Gemara says that a Nochri who kills an Uber, Nochri who performs an abortion, is Chayv Misa, B'dei Adam. The Gemara comments on the Pasuk in the end of Pashtus Nech, Shafech Dam Ba'odam, Kama, Ba'odam Dam Yishafech. One who kills a human being is Chayv Misa B'dei Bezin, Ba'odam Dam Yishafech. So the Gemara has an additional level of interpretation. Torah Shmalpeh has an additional level of interpretation. Shafech Tam Ha'odam Ba'odam. If you kill an Uber who's inside the mother's womb, Dam Yishafech, he's Chayv Misa. So Nochri is Chayv Misa for performing an abortion. So Tosis quotes the Gemara in Sanhedrin. The Gemara says, Mi'ikan Midi, is there such a thing that the Yisrael Mutter, Ben Noach, it's Osir, how can it be? The Jews have more mitzvahs than the Nochrim. If a Nochri is Chayv Misa for killing an Uber, so by the Jews, there must be an Isa as well. There is no Chi of Misa. If a Jew kills an Uber, there's no Chi of Misa. That's a Mishneh Masechas Nida. And we see that, how did the Tanaim know that there's no Chi of Misa? Maybe that Pasuk that says, Shefretam Ba'odam Ba'odam applies to Yisrael also. So the Meiri has this, and the Achrayim were Mechaben on their own to this Meiri, that we know from the Chumash that there's no Chi of Misa by Yisrael who kills an Uber, because the Pasuk tells us there's an institution of Dmei Velodis. So the Torah says, Ki notz anoshem enok for Yishar v'yotzo yelodeho. So the one who caused the baby to die, caused the fetus to die, has to pay the Dmei Velodis. That's in lo yosin, that if the mother doesn't die, mosin yim, and asata nefesh, tachas nefesh, then there's a din of kam lebed rabbin. So even if the mother doesn't die, but the fetus died, so if there would be a chi of misa, there should be kam lebed rabbin. And even if it's b'shoigeg, he didn't intend, ki not sa'noshim, he's fighting with the other person. He didn't intend to kill a fetus. It should still be kam lebed rabbin. That's known as tana debechiskia. So you see from the pasuk that there's no chi of misa. But the question is, how can it be that for a Ben Noach it's an Easter that there's a Chi of Misa, and for Yisrael it's Mutter Legamre? So Tosfos is Machria, it must be that it's an Easter Derais. So that's the accepted opinion. We don't accept the opinion that abortion is only an Easter Derabbanan. We certainly don't accept the opinion that it's Mutter Legamre. The question is, there is an Easter. What is the nature of the Easter? Is it an Easter Ritzicha? Or is it merely an Issa Chavola? An Issa Chavola is a Pasuk in Chumash. One is not permitted to be Chayvul B'Chaveiro, the Yosef Ben Yosef, Alav. And the Gemara says, Osel Odom Lachbal B'Atzma. A person is not a Balabos on his own body. We say in the Davening, Han Shamalach V'Aguf Shalach. The body belongs to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So we're not permitted to perform Chavola on our own body either. So the question is, when one performs an abortion, is that an Issa Chavola? It certainly is an Issa Deraisa. Is that an Issa Chavola? That an Issa Ritzicha? It'll make a major nafkamina. If it's an Issa Ritzicha, then the only time it'll be mutter is when we'll be able to declare that the Uber is a Raidif. You're permitted to kill a Raidif to save the Nirdaf. But if it's merely an Issa Chavola, so we allow Chavola, let's start Tikkun Aguf, if it's in the best health interest of the mother to perform a chavala. Let's say a person has five fingers. Let's say a person has six fingers and he wants to look normal. He wants to remove one finger. So that's chavala l'tzorch tikkun aguf. Let's say a person wants to do cosmetic surgery. They have an ugly face and they want to fix it up. So most of the poskim seem that that's permissible. In the yeshiva years ago, they used to say some machlekes, Rabbi Soloveitchik and Rabbi Soloveitchik, Baron Soloveitchik used to say it's not permissible to do cosmetic surgery, and Rabbi Soloveitchik, Rabbi Yosheb Soloveitchik from Boston, used to say that it's mutter. The Minchas Chitzchok from the Gaivid by the Erech Haredes has tshuvas, long tshuvas. All of his tshuvas, he writes such an arichas on cosmetic surgery. He has a tshuva in one paragraph, mutter. Nothing to discuss, mutter. Usually he quotes on Ashiya. Here he just says mutter. He says there are two girsas in the Rambam. Chav v'chaver derech nitzoyin derech bizoyon. So he says a person does cosmetic surgery, it's neither derech nitzoyon nor is it derech bizoyon. So it's mutter, yours truly. And he signs the tshuva, that's it, nothing to discuss. That's what you usually assume, cosmetic surgery is mutter. So the shaila is, what is the nature of the yisr of abortion? Is it an yisr chavola or is it an yisr ritzicha? And perhaps it's both. Perhaps at one stage it begins as an yisr chavola, maybe at a later stage it becomes an yisr ritzicha. So I remember many years ago, someone was supposed to write there used to be two big magazines in America, Life and Look. I forget which one was which, gigantic magazines. So one of the two, they were going to write a whole write-up about Judaism in America. And Orthodoxy was dying in the 1950s, the late 1950s. So they weren't going to write about Orthodoxy, just going to write about conservative reform. So someone kept on bugging the author that he should go meet Rabbi Soloveitchik and interview him. He didn't want to. Finally, he decided to interview Rabbi Soloveitchik. The whole article was only about Orthodox. They had a picture of Mrs. Fink from Scranton. I was born in Scranton, from Pennsylvania. Mrs. Fink was benching Shabbos licht, closing her eyes with the candlesticks that was on the cover. And they had pictures of Rabbi Soloveitchik giving shiur in the article. So I remember that day the shiur was in English. The shiur used to be in Yiddish at that time. But because the shchoirim, the photographer Shachar, who was taking the photographs of Rabbi Soloveitchik, wanted to impress him. Rabbi Soloveitchik was saying Latin expressions and Greek expressions and fancy English. He was giving high. We happened to be learning the Gemara on Daf Ayin Beis about abortion in Sanhedrin. That was the second year. Rabbi Soloveitchik learned Sanhedrin 2 years in a row, and he finished all the 90 blot. He just didn't do the Agadat and Perek Chelek. He did all the halacha, 90 blot in 2 years, not like now, that they only cover 5 blot a year. He covered 45 blot every year. So I remember that day he was giving the shiur. So he assumed that within the first 40 days, the Gemara says, Maya Bialma, the maximum you can say is that it's an Issa Chavola. It doesn't make sense to say that it's an Issa Ritzich. Question is, after the Tzuras Havlad is Nikr, about 44 days, 43 days, something like that. So at some point after 40 days. So then it's a question, what is the nature of the Isser of abortion? Is it already an Isser Ritzicha, or is it still only an Isser Havola? So the Gemara quotes a Mishnah from Aholos, that if a woman, a woman is in labor, and the woman's life is in danger because of this pregnancy, she runs a risk of losing her life. So the Mishnah says, if Hotzi Rosha, if the baby was already Yolud, the head of the baby came out, is considered Yolud. So then you're not allowed to kill the Uber to save the mother. Ain't docha nefesh mitnei nefesh. But if lo Hotzi Rosha, if the baby wasn't born yet, so Rashi says he's not yet a nefesh, it's not an Issa Ritzicha, Pashab Shan Rashi said, then it's only an Issa Chavola. So if it's an Issa Chavola, so b'mokam pikoch nefesh, we would allow Chavola. So Rashi seems to learn, even though the woman is in labor, it's still only an Issa Chavola. He's not yet a nefesh, and the Issa Ritzicha doesn't set in until after Hotzi Rosh. That's the Pashab Shat in the Gemara. The Ramam has a different shot. The Rambam says, even lo hotzi roshi, he permitted to kill the uber to save the mother, because we consider the uber a roidev. The Rambam quotes, if the uber is a roidev, so even if hotzi roshi also, he should be permitted to kill the uber. Usually a roidev is the person who's born is chasing after someone else. And Gemara says, no. The Rambam says, that's not called the roidev. It's not called the roidev. So how does the Rambam say that he's a roidev if it's lo hotzi rosho? So it's a difficult Rambam. So the Achrayim already has the kash, and the tshuva is going in Basroi from the days of the Marsho, in the Maharam. So the Achrayim worked on this difficult Rambam. So it's a problematic Rambam. So Rabbi Moshe Feinstein has a tshuva, and he writes, just because you have a kash on the Rambam, you can't reject the Rambam. And he quotes Rab Chaim Soloveitchik as the Yeshiva on the Rambam. Doesn't explain fully what Rab Chaim said, but it's a famous Rab Chaim. Rab Chaim is quoted by Rabbi Zalman Meltzer in the Eben Ha'ozel. There is presented much better than the way it's in the Chidush Rab Chaim himself. Rabbi Zalman presents it better. So he explains the two dinim of Roidev. The Rambam has the very page, this is the first page in Hilchos Ratzeach, the very page before the end of Chayv Olamazik, the Rambam has the din, Sfina Shechashva Lehishavim Ipnei Koibin Hamasui. There's a boat that's transporting passengers and it has heavy luggage, and the luggage is so heavy, the boat is going to sink and everyone's life is besakon, everybody can drown. So you're permitted, he quotes the Gemara in the end of Baba Kama, you're permitted to throw over some of the heavy luggage in order to save the people's lives. So Pashup Shat, it's an Issa Mazik, you're throwing the person's property over into the ocean, it's going to be destroyed, going to be lost forever. But it's mutter to do it, because the pikuach nefesh is permitted to be masik. The question is, hamatz latzmam chaver, maybe you have to pay, maybe you don't have to pay. So the Rambam says you don't have to pay because the masui is a roidev. Masui is a roidev. Masui is a human being who's doing redifa consciously. It's an accident. The heavy luggage, you see the Rambam holds that there are two dinim of roidev. There's a human being who's a roidev consciously doing redifa. Then there's another din of roidev by an inanimate object, or by an Uber who's not born yet. That's a second din of roidev. If this is causing people to possibly lose their lives, that's also a din of roidev. That's what the Rambam says, you put them from paying for the hezek. If you threw over the luggage, certainly permissible to throw luggage over. Pikuach nefesh is decha di isra avodah mamazik, but the pikuach nefesh doesn't part you from paying. But since the koibet hamasui has the status of a roidev, it's a roidev b'shevi altasa. So the Uber is also a roidev b'shevi altasa. So that's why the Rambam says it's permissible to kill the Uber. So the fact that the Rambam writes that it's mutter to kill the Uber because the Uber is a roidev on this level, you see, otherwise it would have been an Issa Ritzicha on the Uber, not just an Issa Chavolah. So an Issa Chavolah could have said Pikuach Nefesh of the mother is Dach Issa Chavolah. The Rambam had to come on to write it because he holds that it's an Issa Ritzicha. So that's a Machloikas Rashi and the Rambam. The Pashtus is not like the Rambam. Ram came up with a whole fantastic interpretation in the Gemara. So in the Tshuva of the Torah's Chesed, he suggests that even according to the Rambam, who holds that it's an Issa Ritzicha, it could be that it's only because Yoshva Amashber, the woman is already in labor. So it's already Nekah Havlat Lotzeis. So then you can say it's an Issa Ritzicha, but before the woman goes into labor, it could be the Rambam would also agree to Rashi that it's only an Issa of Chavala. Or it could even be if the Rambam would think, even before Yoshva Lamashber, it's already an Issa Ritzicha, but maybe it's only because Kolola Chadosha, because it's already full-term pregnancy. Full-term is a machlekes in the Gemara. When is it considered full-term? Full-term, Yoledes Letisha, is Yoledes L'mekutoyin, or not Yoledes L'mekutoyin? Full-term pregnancy means she entered into the beginning of the ninth month, or she had 9 full months of 30 days each. Not every other month is 29 days, 9 full months of 30 days each. So that's what, in the days of the Gemara, that was the psak. Yoledes Letisha, by us, we assume every pregnancy is 9 months. Somehow in the days of the Gemara, they had some kind of an idea. There are two types of pregnancy. There's a 7-month pregnancy and a 9-month pregnancy. If a baby is born in the 8th month, you have to figure out, is it a post-mature 7-month pregnancy, or is it a premature 9-month pregnancy? So the Gemara says it depends whether the 8th month, if the baby's born in the 8th month, does it have all the fingernails already? Does it have already hair? So then it's kolola hadosha. It shows that it's a post-mature 7-month pregnancy. And if it doesn't have the fingernails, doesn't have the hair yet, so then we assume it's a premature 9-month pregnancy. In Shulchan Aruch, they quote the Ritva Ritva says, we don't know what this means. They never heard of a 7-month pregnancy. We only know about 9-month pregnancies. So what's considered a 9-month pregnancy? So in the days of the Gemara, the assumption was that Yoledes Letisha, a 9-month pregnancy, and Yoledes Lemukutoin. It's not enough if you entered into the beginning of the 9th month, it has to be 9 full months of 30 days each. That's called full-term pregnancy. By the time it came, the days of the Shulchan Aruch, so the Raman, the end of Eben Ezer, quotes from the Tshuvas HaTashbeitz, that was manazet, all the doctors say that it's perfectly normal to have a baby as long as you entered into the beginning of the 9th month. Doesn't have to be kolo chadoshev, full 9 months. Beginning of the 9th month is also good. That's how we pass in the hokel. Ben l'hokel, ben l'hachma, we pass in like that. So the Torah's chesed suggests, even according to the question of the Rambam, had a chiddush over here that you need a redifa. You need that the ubi should be labeled as a roidif in order to be permitted to kill the ubi, because otherwise it's an isa ritzicha. So he thinks maybe the Rambam only said it when the woman is already in labor, or maybe even if the Rambam said it before she goes into labor, maybe it's only if it's kolol l'chadosha, she already entered into the beginning of the 9th month. But if it's before the beginning of the 9th month, the vlad is not viable vlad yet. Today it's viable. You can put the baby into an incubator. They can take care of the baby, but on its own, the vlad is not, won't be a bar kayoma. So the Torah's chesed thinks that there's room to be mekum. That it's only an isa chavola, and whenever it's letzorach tikkun haguf, for the good well-being of the mother. Let's say they tested the embryo, they tested the vlad, and it turns out it's going to be a Tay-Sachs baby. So the mother's going to have yogan v'anachah for years. She's going to have to take care of this baby after some other major disease, a major sickness. So she's going to have to be metapal on the baby. So in such a case, we would permit chavola, if the whole prohibition is only chavola. According to Rashi and the Pashtus, all the other Rishonim leaving out the Rambam, certainly only an isa chavola. And even according to the Rambam, that it's an isa ritzichas, the Rav Soloveitchik caught the first 40 days for sure, before Mem Yom, for sure it's only an isa chavola, not an isa ritzicha. And the Torah's chesed thought that there's room to be mekel even after. So that's why we decided that in this situation, that the single girl became pregnant, and they're going to certainly drop her. If they're going to let her have the pregnancy, they're certainly going to drop her from the Beis Yankiv, and then they're not going to take her into any religious school, and the parents are not yet observant, so they're probably not going to be able to develop to become a religious girl. So the Rabbanim there decided to follow the kula of the Torah's chesed. It's a davi yodua that here in Eretz Yisrael, the Tzitz Eliezer disagreed with Rav Shlomo Zalman Auerbach. Shlomo Zalman was machmer like Rav Moshe felt. Rav Moshe disagreed with Rav Soloveitchik. He thought you have to be machmer for the Rambam. Everyone has to be machmer for the Rambam, even though the Pashas and Gemara is not like the Rambam. Everyone should be machmer for the Rambam. And even within the first 40 days, Rav Moshe held that it's only mutter to terminate the pregnancy if the mother's life is bisakona. He thinks it has to be korav levadai that it's bisakona. That's a chiddush to Rav Moshe. Only korav levadai, but the mother's life is bisakana. The Teferes Yisrael HaMishnah on that Mishnah says that even if there's a suffix also, you're allowed to kill you. Rav Moshe thought only if it's kemat korav levadai, that the mother's life is bisakana. So Rav Moshe is machmer, even within the first 40 days, that you're only allowed to kill the yuber if the yuber is a roidif, if the mother's life is korav levadai bisakana. Now, Rav Soloveitchik thought within the first 40 days, even the Rambam would agree, it's only Nisa Chavola, so the Tzorch Tikkun HaGuf of the mother would be Mutta. After 40 days, then it's Machlokes as the Rambam and Rov HaRishonim. Rav Soloveitchik said, you should really follow the Rov HaRishonim. Then it's not a Nisa Ritzich, only a Nisa Chavola. So the Tzorch Tikkun HaGuf should be Mutta. Rav Soloveitchik said when he was giving that shiur in English, when the photographer was taking all the photographs, so he said he personally finds it difficult to be Mekel against the Rambam. He used to use the Rambam a lot. He would find it difficult to be Mekel. But the Pashto says you should be Mekel. It's an Issa lo Sirtzach. We're talking about an Issa lo Sirtzach. But Yav Machlek is the Rambam and all the Rishayim. With all the respect that we have for the Rambam, but if he's outvoted, so we follow the majority opinion. So the Pashto says that Rov HaRishayim don't agree with the Rambam. And then even the Teres Cheses, that even one follows the Rambam, maybe the Rambam held that it's Ritzicha only when it's called Lechadoshav, when you already entered into the beginning of the 9th month, and maybe the Rambam only said it when she's already Yoshva La Mashma. Many years ago, it was at an OU weekend in upstate New York by Niagara Falls. So the rabbi from Rochester was with the group. And there was a doctor from Rochester also who had done his medical stage, whatever you call it, his residency in Eretz Yisrael. And when he spent time in Eretz Yisrael, he became close with Reb Shlomo Zalman Auerbach. So there was a woman in the community in Rochester who was extremely overweight, and she had difficulty getting a shidduch till she finally got a shidduch. It was a big anasek. Then she had difficulty becoming pregnant. She finally became pregnant. It was a big simcha. Then she finds out that she's carrying tesex baby. So the shaila was, is she permitted to perform an abortion? So she asked the local rabbi. So the rabbi in Rochester didn't get these shailas every other day. So he asked the doctor, can he please call Reb Shlomo Zalman Auerbach? Because he knew him personally. Ask him what to do. So the doctor called Reb Shlomo. Doctor was telling me this story. Doctor called Reb Shlomo Zalman. And he tells him the whole story. Took her a long time till she got a shidduch. Took a long time till she became pregnant. And now she realizes she has a sick baby and she's going to be, it's going to be tzoris, tzoris. If she goes through with the pregnancy, is she permitted to perform an abortion? So Shlomo Zalman says, they're talking in Hebrew, he says, you know, my opinion, I hold that it's not permissible. There's nothing to discuss. So the doctor has it over again. But the woman, till she got a shidduch, until she became pregnant, a whole arichas, it's a rachmanas on the woman. So the doctor said, he tells Reb Shlomo Zalman, maybe think it over, tomorrow I'll call you again. So Reb Shlomo Zalman said, I don't know what there is to call me tomorrow. Okay, call me tomorrow. But you know my opinion, I hold that it's us. So he called him tomorrow, calls him up the next day. He says, tagid li isha. Sheyesh poisek before Sam Yerushalayim. Tell the woman that the tzitzeli, as it says, is mutter. The woman is not mechuyev, she's not by Talmud. She doesn't have to follow my shita. Tell the woman, don't tell her there's a machloikis, and I told you that it's also, you know what I hope. Tell her there's a pesach mefus in Yerushalayim. It says that it's mutter. The woman is not mechuyev to listen to my shita. He thought it over overnight. He didn't change his opinion. He said the woman is not mechuyev to follow my opinion. It's an interesting. Reb Shlomo Zalman had that attitude by other issues also. Afroshes Maestris, he had personally had chumras. When people would ask Mashiach, they would say, this and this basic says it's mutter. They're not mechuyev to follow his chumras. They're not his talmidim. They're not his chassidim. So he said on this issue as well, that he didn't think that the woman was mechuyev to follow his sheep. So basically when Yeshiva University had a medical ethics hotline for a while, I think a year or two. So people would call up sometimes. Doctors would call, sometimes the families would call. So the two rabbinical advisors for the medical ethics hotline were Rabbi Tendler and myself. So Rabbi Tendler was very eish lehover. He said, you can only say over Rabbi Moshe Feinstein's opinion. You can't tell him that there's any other sheet. You have to tell a woman that it's an iser to do an abortion, even if in the first 40 days. No heter at all. Even l'tzorach tikun haguf. And I thought that that wasn't fair. Not everyone is mechuyev to follow Rabbi Moshe, like not everyone is mechuyev to follow Rabbi Shlomo Zalman. Shlomo Zalman said, tagid li isha, sheish poisek mefutz. We should tell the people, there's a machloikis. If you always follow everything that Rabbi Moshe Feinstein says, you have to follow him on this as well. But if you don't always follow Rabbi Moshe, there's room to be makel over here. When people ask me the shaila, that's what I tell them. And I tell them, if Chalila would be one of my children, I would recommend that they should follow the cooler opinion. It can ruin your life. I know chaverim of mine, I know students of mine whose wives had sick children and it ruined their marriage. Some of them got divorced. They couldn't function with a sick child. And some of them didn't get divorced, but their marriage was destroyed. If you have a sick child like that, it can destroy your life. So it's quite an achrayus to say lahachmer in these issues. If you go to Rabbi Moshe Feinstein, he tells you to be machmer. He gives you a bracha. Everything should work out well. That's one thing. But to tell a person he should be machmer because Rabbi Moshe says lachumer, not so easy. Not so easy. So this is when people ask me the shaila, it's a very difficult, very serious shaila. But there certainly is room to be makel. The Tzitz Eliezer thinks that it's only permissible in the first trimester. I don't say that over. I don't understand why it should be only the first trimester. I thought like the Torah's Chesed, everything was based on the Torah's Chesed. Torah's Chesed says that up until Yoshua Lamashber, or up until the beginning of the ninth month, even the Rambam would agree that it's only an Issa Chabola, an Issa Chabola. If it's for the good health of the mother, to maintain her good health, one would be permitted to do such a hapala. We should all be spared from these miserable shilas, and we should all be healthy. Thank you.
Harav Professor Avraham Steinberg is a scientist, a physician, director of the Medical Ethics Unit at Shari Tzedek Medical Center, and the co-chair of Israel's National Council on Bioethics. He's also the chairman of the Encyclopedia Talmudic, celebrating its 75th anniversary, and a recipient of the Israel Prize. Professor Steinberg.
Bershus Mardeasra. It's an opportunity to again thank the Rosh Yeshiva for supporting the Talmudic Encyclopedia for many years, and especially now that you came here for Yeshiva University, but also for the event that we had, the 75th anniversary of the Talmudic Encyclopedia, and really a guest of honor, and we thank you very much for your ongoing support. Thank you. This is the Talmudic Encyclopedia up to volume Membet, but actually last week, volume Memches came out already, so it's going more rapidly than I can update my presentations. The topic that I'm going to cover in a very broad manner, without going into every detail, are all kinds of reproductive technologies, what they are, and what it comes from a halachic point of view. So everyone wants to have children, wants to have nice children, smart children, and particularly healthy children. And it doesn't matter what the culture is, what the color is, everyone is wants to be a parent, a mother or a father, but not everyone can, because there are many issues of infertility. Just on a humoristic way, doesn't work. Oh, there's a meeting between a Nobel Prize laureate, Anatole France, and a beautiful dancer by the name of Isadora Duncan in 1923. Duncan, the dancer, says, "Just imagine a child with my beauty and your brains." Says friends, "Yes, but imagine a child with my beauty and your brains." So not always are the shiduchim coming out the way everyone wants. So the infertility issue is a worldwide problem. There are over 100 million couples at any given time that have fertility problems throughout the world. Some are because of male factors, others because of female factors, and some because of many factors. And we know that fertility is a blessing and infertility is a curse. A woman that doesn't have children is, like Rachel said, "Give me children, otherwise I am dead." There is a feeling of loss without having children. And it's not only on the woman's side, it's also on the man's side. A childless man, an ariri, is as if he is dead, again, from a psychological point of view. And actually, the first biblical commandment of the Taryag Mitzvot is be fruitful and multiply. So it's not only a psychological, a worldwide feeling, but it's actually the first mitzvah of Taryag Mitzvahs. And we know that our foremothers, many of them where barren women, finally, all of them had children, but Chazal say that those many of our ancestors were barren because HaKadosh Baruch Hu desires the prayers of the righteous. So indeed they are praying, but the fact is that the life is difficult if you can't have children. Now, in general, we divide the intervention in fertility issues into two major types of interventions. One is planning the family. On the one hand, reducing the size of the family, like using contraceptives and abortion, as we just now heard the halachic approach to it, or to enlarge the family when otherwise, in natural ways, it is impossible by using artificial insemination, in vitro insemination, and so on. Programming, which I won't talk about, is not only having children, but having normal children. And therefore, we can use PGD, stem cell engineering, and genetic therapy. This is a part that we are not going to talk about. So one question is, are we allowed to treat infertility altogether? One of the problems is that in order to treat infertility, sometimes the man has to emit semen for testing, for using it to fertilize eggs outside the womb. Is there an issue of emitting semen for not? But the overall halachic approach is that to help a couple from its mental anguish, not being able to have a child, is a meritorious act, and therefore it is permissible, and actually emitting semen is not for naught, it is for the same purpose as having a normal intercourse, and therefore halachically, at least after the first generation where there were such discussions, whether it's at all permissible, currently all, certainly most poskim don't see a problem in emitting semen for the purpose of procreation, which is what is done in a natural way. So that is really not an issue. There are some ethical issues involved in this type of intervention, some of which I'll describe in a few minutes. So on the one hand, science and technology per se are morally neutral. The fact that we can do a treatment that will enable an infertile couple to have a child by ways that a few generations ago, not only wasn't it feasible, but it wasn't even imaginable. The things that we are doing today can be done, but the fact that we're doing it is morally neutral. That's a scientific fact. The question is, from a social moral point of view, is the use of this type of science and technology, and from our point of view, from the halachic point of view, is it a permissible act or are there prohibitions from a halachic point of view? So the technology by itself can be neutral, but the use of it may have problems. And actually there are two wide problems in all these new technologies. One is quote unquote playing God, and the other one is interference with nature. So the concept of playing God, I put it in parentheses, is not a Jewish concept. No one can play God. God, in essence, is an entity or whatever we can call it that can do something from nothing. No human being ever before and in the future can do something from nothing. All we do in all the technologies and the innovations is a technical matter rather than a fundamental, and actually it is using what is existing and revealing the existing nature, but not creating something new. So by enhancing the knowledge, actually, if you look at it with open eyes, it is a way to enhance the belief in HaKadosh Baruch Hu, because when we see a plan, there must have been a planner. We know it from everybody's experience on a daily life that whenever there is a plan, someone planned it. This building didn't come up by itself, someone planned it. So the more we know, the more we reveal, the more we understand that there is an Almighty that does all of it, but that is not a way that we can play God, so to speak. The more questionable issue is, are we allowed to interfere with nature in such a significant way? And the answer is that certainly it's permissible, but perhaps even required. I won't go into so many sources to point to the fact that we are allowed to intervene in nature, but I'll give you just two, three examples. The Pasuk says, Verapo Yerape, and heal, he should heal. Says the Gemara in Bava Kamma, from here, one derives a healer's permission to heal. And the obvious question is, why does a physician need a permission to be a physician? We don't find a permission to be a carpenter or a permission to be a shoemaker. Why does a physician need to get the permission? Says Rashi, because we do not say God smites and man heals. Kodesh Baruch Hu Machi ve'ihu Masi. We could have thought that a physician is interfering with God's providence. God wanted this person to be sick. God wanted this person to be disabled. God wanted this person to be injured. Who are you, human being, that you interfere in nature and you heal this person? So the Hava Amina was that a human being shouldn't be allowed to do it. And in fact, in Chazal's day, there was a whole movement called the Isim from the term Asya. Asya is a physician who said that a physician is not permitted to interfere with HaKadosh Baruch Hu's wish or act in the way. Says the Torah, Verapo Yerape, you are allowed to heal the person. Why? Because you are partner to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. You're not going against HaKadosh Baruch Hu. HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants the person to be sick. HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave you the intelligence and the means, and you can do it as a shaliach for the Kodesh Baruch Hu to heal this person. And in fact, if you will be successful or not, it's dependent on Kodesh Baruch Hu. It's not that you are the big hero that you do it. It all depends on Kodesh Baruch Hu, but it is not regarded as a prohibited interference with nature. At the end of Vayechulu, it says, Asher bara Elokim la'asot, says the Medrash, if the acts of HaKadosh Baruch Hu in the sixth day of creation was finished, was completed, should have said, Asher bara Elokim ve'asa. He did and he completed. La'asot means to be continued, to be done further on. And therefore, who is doing it further on? Human beings. And in fact, all what we see around us is interference in nature. This building wasn't here built by Kodesh Baruch Hu in the 6 days of creation. This is a human act that created this place, and therefore there's no reason to feel bad about interfering with nature. So as I said, in planning infertility situations, we can use either artificial insemination or in vitro fertilization. Today we can even transplant testicles and ovaries and uteruses. And the question is if this interference is halachically permissible. In principle, it is permissible because infertility is a curse. Infertility is a terrible situation. And if we can treat it, we should treat it. But are there halachic prohibitions to do so? When we talk about artificial insemination, where do we get the semen in order to inseminate when there is a problem? So we can get it from the husband to his wife. We can get it from a donor to a single woman. We can get it from a donor to a married woman. We can get it from an anonymous source, such as a bank of semen that we don't know. And also it can be a Jewish donor or a Gentile donor, and it can be taken while the donor is still alive, but also taken after he died. And all these create specific questions that have been dealt. So if the source is the husband, so why do we need to do artificial insemination between a couple, between a husband and a wife. So there might be anatomic disturbances on the male's organs, so he cannot do it naturally. There can be functional disturbances of the sperm. The sperm isn't good enough, and therefore it can't impregnate. And there's a whole host of reasons why, despite the fact that there is a couple, the male factor is the cause for the infertility. So what are the halachic considerations here? Interestingly, that the first source in history, in human history, that insemination or impregnation can happen without a direct relationship between a man and a woman is already in a Gemara, and all the historians of medicine quote this as a idea that already Chazal foresaw such an option. And the sugya in Chagiga has to do with a kohen gadol that, as we know, is allowed to marry only a virgin woman, as opposed to a regular kohen that is forbidden to marry a grusha, but he is allowed to marry an almana, who is not a virgin anymore. But a kohen gadol is allowed to marry only a besula, only a virgin woman. So the question is, betula she'ibra ma'u lekohen gadol? If you have a pregnant woman that is a virgin, is she allowed to kohen gadol? How could a virgin become pregnant? And the answer is, chayshinan shema ba'ambati ibra. In those days, there weren't showers in homes. There were public bathhouse, and one after the other went into this bathhouse. And the chashash is that a male came to bath in this bathhouse, and a woman followed him, and she became impregnated by artificial insemination, by the semen of the man that entered into her body without a direct relationship. This concept, until 100 or less years, was unimaginable that it can happen, and today it happens. I won't go into the whole sugya and into the question whether it practically could have happened, but the idea was already there. So the rule from a halachic point of view is that a Jewish sperm donor is the father by definition, no matter how it happened, whether he is a legitimate husband of his wife, whether he is another Jew that had relations with a married woman and the child is a mamzer, yet he is the father because the sperm came from him. And therefore, no matter where the sperm comes from, if it's a Jewish donor, he by a definition is the father of this child. So therefore, if we are talking about a husband, even though the sperm didn't come directly in a direct relationship between husband and wife, but came via artificial insemination from his semen, he will be the father, despite the fact that it didn't happen in a natural way. Now, sometimes we use a freezing of sperm prior to the relationship and even prior to marriage. And that is in case where, let's say, a young person has to undergo chemotherapy or radiotherapy because he has a malignancy. So we know that these treatments cause sterility to the male. In order for him to be able to have children, if he survives his disease, we can take his sperm prior to the treatment, freeze it, give him the treatment, and hopefully after the treatment, he will survive, and either he's already married or he will get married. We can use his frozen sperm in order to fertilize his wife, and the child will be his, despite the fact that now he is unable to do it naturally. Now, if the donor is someone other than the husband, then it can happen, for instance, if the husband have no sperm at all, or there is a genetic disease and we don't want to let him go, that will depend who this foreign donor to the couple is. Is it a Jew or is it a Gentile? If it is a Jew, then there is a question of mamzerus, because the woman is married and the sperm comes from a Jew other than her husband. But because it's not done in the natural way, there's a machloikes whether this causes mamzerus. So there are some shittes who hold that it doesn't matter where this foreign sperm came from, the child will be a mamzer. There are shittes that it has to be only in direct relationship, otherwise there is no mamzerus. And there's a shitta that he is a suffolk mamzer, which we don't know if this is a form that creates mamzerus. There might be also other questions, such as Shema Yisa'ach et Achoto. If this sperm donor, Jewish sperm donor, has his own children with his wife, and he donated his sperm to another Jewish couple, and he disappears, and now he has a daughter, and from his sperm to the couple, a boy was born, they may meet, and they are actually brother-sister from a father's side, which is a brother-sister relationship, and their children certainly will be regarded as mamzerim. So Shema Yisa'ach es Achoiso is a concern in this situation. There might also be a situation where the sperm donor is not a Kohen, whereas the husband of the wife, who is not the father of the child, is a Kohen, and when he goes to shul with his with the son of the couple, everyone assumes it's his son, so everyone might assume that he is also a Kohen. And then if he dochens, it's a brocha lebatola, and so on. So these are questions that come up, and therefore, certainly halachically, a Jewish sperm donor is not allowed at all to be considered. It is different if we are talking about a Gentile donor, because a father, halachically, if he is a Gentile, has no yachas to his children. So there's certainly no mamzerus. There's also no chsha shema yisa'ach et achoto, even though biologically he is the father of his daughters and the father of the son that was born from his sperm. Halachically, they are not brothers and sisters. And therefore, halachically, that is an option that a Gentile donor can help in a case where the husband has no sperm or there's other problems. Some hesitate because we don't want to introduce foreign DNA into our nation, but that is more a conceptual fear rather than a pure halachic consideration, and therefore that can be regarded at least. Now, interestingly, there may be situations where the father, the owner of the sperm is not alive anymore, and yet after his death, a child is born. For instance, the example I gave earlier, a young man who is married and has now cancer, and he froze his sperm, he underwent chemotherapy or radiotherapy, and he died. He didn't survive the disease. Now we have in the bank his frozen semen, which we can inseminate to his wife. And the child will be born after the father was long dead. Is there a father-child relationship in such a condition? That's a machloikis today, between, especially in writing, between Rav Shlomo Zalman Neuerbach and Arav Israeli. Again, I don't want to go into all the details of it, but currently, I think that most poskim would say that he is the father, for instance, for inheritance or for other father functions as such. About Yibum Chalitza, there is a big discussion whether the woman would need Yibum Chalitza despite the fact that he is a child. But a more complicated situation would be if a male died and he didn't even leave sperm frozen. And we still, within 24 hours after he died, we are able to obtain his semen. And we can take this semen and inseminate it to a woman. Not only will the male father, potential father, not be in the world when the child will be born, but even a semen wasn't in the world before he died. And yet we use his semen and we have a child. Is this a father-child relationship? Complicated situations, we face it from time to time. Can't hear? Zera lo chayav kura. No. Yes, Sheila, there is a question whether there is a nivul ames by doing the procedure, but if it's for his benefit, probably it won't be such a thing. I'll just skip a little bit into the IVF in vitro fertilization situation. So again here, there may be many sources for the egg or the womb of a woman that can't have children, either because she has no ovaries or because she has no womb. And it can be the husband's sperm with the wife's egg, and yet we need to do an in vitro fertilization procedure because, for instance, the fallopian tubes of the mother are blocked, and therefore the egg from the ovary can't meet the sperm that comes from the other side because they meet in the fallopian tube, and that is blocked. So we have to take out the egg from the woman, take out the sperm from her husband, fertilize it in the lab, and bring it back into the womb in order for a child to be born. And obviously that is halachically sanctioned because it's all within the couple. But sometimes we need a donor of a womb, which is called a surrogate mother, because let's say the woman of the couple underwent hysterectomy and she has no womb. So although she has eggs, but she can't carry the pregnancy, or vice versa, she has no ovaries and she can carry the pregnancy, but she has no eggs. So we need an egg donor. In these situations, the major question that comes up is who is the mother in such a situation? In other words, to be a mother, a woman has to fulfill two functions, as opposed to the male, that to be a father, he has to fulfill only one act, meaning that a male to become a father has to donate the 50% of the genetic material, which will create the fetus, which is his sperm. So he can give his sperm, go away for 9 months, come back, and Moshe Grois is the father. He didn't have to do anything between this act and the other. Whereas the woman, in order to be a mother, has two functions. She has to give the other 50% of the genetic material, which is the egg, but she has to carry the pregnancy into the delivery. Now, if we separate the two functions of a woman as a mother, one is giving the genetic material, donating the egg, and one is giving the womb, carrying the pregnancy and delivering, who of the two is the mother? And that is very debatable nowadays. On the one hand, we could argue that the genetic mother, the egg donor, is the mother because biologically the genes are what makes us as human beings. And the uterus, we can look at it just as an incubator, just as a place where the baby is growing, but really not connected to motherhood, so the egg donor should be the mother. Halachically, there are all kinds of support to this idea. I won't go into it. So this is one side of the coin. The other side of the coin is to say that the gestational mother is the mother because the bonding between the mother and the child occurs while the baby is growing in her uterus. We know today by epigenetic that the environment is as important or sometimes less or sometimes even more than the genetic material. So the environment where the baby is growing is the motherhood, and the egg can be a chip or something unrelated, although it's genetically important. What? Partnership between the two women. Okay, we'll come to it in a minute, but that's another option. But this option is to say that only the gestational mother is the mother, and there are all kinds of sources to support this opinion. And indeed, when this technology came about, all the rabbonim that I know argued one to this side, one to that side, and everyone tried to bring a raya. I had the opportunity to discuss this matter like many others with Reb Shlom Zalman Neuerbach, and we went over all the rayas, all the sources that all the other rabbonim brought, and he brought some others as well, and he decided that neither is applicable to this situation. There was never a situation where there was a separation between the two functions of motherhood into two different women. There were situations where technically within the same mother, there was a change, like she was goyete when she started the pregnancy, and then she underwent giyur and she became Jewish. So the question is there chalitza and yibum? Is there eishes ach? And all kinds of such questions. But these are within the same person. But to have two separate persons, each with a separate function, he said that according to his opinion, there is no precedence in halacha and we can't solve the problem. Now, what do you do when you can't solve the problem? It's like many teikus in Shas, that even the Tanoim D'Amorim couldn't solve certain problems and they left a teiku. But the halacha, we have rules. When there is a teiku, what do you do? Is it a Doraisa, you go to Chumra? Is it a Rabbonon, you go to Kula? And various halachic procedures. And therefore, his opinion was that the mother, that both are mothers, lechumra, misofek. We don't know if the egg donor is the mother, we don't know if the surrogate mother is the mother, and therefore we take both women as mothers, lechumra. And there are many nafkeminis why, what happens if both are mothers, lechumra. For instance, if either of the two women is not Jewish, the child will need a giyur, because maybe the non-Jewish part, either the egg donor or the surrogate, if she's non-Jewish, is the mother, and therefore the child is not Jewish, so he needs a giyur. A child will not be able to marry siblings from either woman, because maybe this is his mother, and therefore this is his half-sister, or maybe this is his mother, and so on. The child will not be able to heir, to get the Yerusha from either woman, because every woman, every child of a woman will say, how do you know that this is your mother? Maybe the other one is your mother and you can't get the monetary compensation from this woman. And so on. There are a lot of nafkeminos in this case, and we... No, Pidyon, yeah. So Pidyon HaBen has really nothing to do with who is the mother, except that if we call the mother that even is an egg donor, but she didn't deliver, there's no Pidyon HaBen on her side. So therefore we can't use her as a mother for Pidyon HaBen. So that's in a negative way. Incidentally, when we do a giyur on a child of this kind, what brocha do we make at the time that we make the milah? If it is a Jewish child, then the brocha is ala milah, and lachniso bevriso shel Avraham Avinu. If it is l'shem giyur, then the brocha is lamul esageirim, and there is no lachniso bevriso shel Avraham Avinu. So what brocha do you make? Think about it. So I think that there are a lot of other issues involved in infertility treatments. There are a lot of shilas that come up. There are newer things that I, again, time is late. I don't want to go into it. I just wanted to give you a brief overview of the many questions that the treatment for infertility creates. But despite all the questions, if we have such a treatment and we can help a couple, we should do it and try to solve the problems. It's the problems of the rabbonim, not of the couple. The couple should have the benefit of having a treatment to their infertility, and we have to find the right solutions. Thank you.
And please, if you have any questions, to direct them to who you'd like to direct the questions to.
Does it matter now that the